I'm Ashton Addison from EventChain for Investment Pitch Media and FinTech News Network. And today on Blockchain Interviews, we have Yat Sui, the chairman and co-founder of Animoca Brands, the company behind F1 Delta Time and the Rev Token. Yat, welcome to the show and thanks for taking the time to be here.
Pleasure to be here.
I'm really excited for our discussion today. You guys have a lot of exciting stuff going on. And Animoca Brands is doing a lot of things, and we're going to dive into F1 Delta Time, but let's just kick it off with what is Animoca Brands all about, and how are you guys working in the blockchain space right now?
So Animoca Brands is a traditional gaming company that has been making games for many, many years now. In fact, its predecessor version of Animoca is like maybe over 10 years old. And we sort of found, call it blockchain religion, when we got involved with CryptoKitties like 2.5 years ago. And I think that's when we realized that there's a big new paradigm in gaming. So we went all in on that concept, which is basically true digital ownership, or effectively what we describe as property rights for gamers. So we've now have multiple gaming projects in that space, including F1 Delta Time, the Sandbox, the Rev Token, and also made investments in that space. So we believe that this is going to be not just the next paradigm in gaming, but just generally, potentially even the future of work.
Mm-hmm. It's really interesting. And yeah, when you got involved, when CryptoKitties first exploded, it seemed that the blockchain gaming industry was sort of early on, and now it's exploded even more. And I think that we're still early on, and there's a lot to grow still. So, you know, what was the potential that you saw back then, and what sort of inspired you to expand out into F1 Delta Time?
Well, so maybe this is a good time for me to basically show something here, which is the gaming industry as a whole. So first of all, the gaming industry is a large industry. Last year, we had $150 billion in revenue, which is bigger than movies and music combined. And the other thing that's interesting about the gaming industry is that, you know, anywhere from 50 to or 60 to like $100 billion of these of that revenue came from virtual assets. Now, the crazy thing, of course, is that these virtual assets inside these games actually aren't owned by the owners who bought them, or they think they own them. In fact, they're kind of rented. The only beneficiary are the players themselves. And then the other thing that we also saw is, well, you know, how do we bring about blockchain adoption? And, you know, this excitement that we saw of CryptoKitties translate to general gamers. And we're like, wait, hold on a second. Gamers actually understand virtual currency already because they're spending them on games. And they also understand virtual assets, except they don't really own them, but they do understand the paradigm behind that. So that's kind of how we said, you know what, maybe this is the space in which we could make a big impact and turn that paradigm around to allow people to really own their assets. And I think the main thing here to talk about is, you know, this concept of this non-fungible token. And the non-fungible token uses the same technology that makes Bitcoin possible through the blockchain. But instead of having fungible tokens, as in one token is the same as every other, you have a non-fungible token where every token is different, which means that every asset can now be scarce and unique and have also a history and a provenance attached to it. And maybe just to conclude, why is it that we think gamers need it? Is because they don't own anything. There's 2.6 billion people, more than half of the world's internet, that is basically playing games right now, but they don't own their assets. Mm-hmm. And if we do that, we actually think it'll create an economic revolution where they can trade their assets, they can use them in other games, much like free trade has done for the real world.
Mm-hmm. That's super interesting. Yeah, and yeah, the being able to own your own data and your own assets is a huge paradigm shift, especially in the gaming industry when there's so many people spending hours and hours doing things that, you know, they don't really end up owning anything at the end of the day. So super interesting. And now you've moved that into F1 Delta Time in a specific industry to, you know, capitalize on these opportunities. Can you just talk a little bit about what is F1 Delta Time? Why did you move into that space?
Yes, well, so first of all, you know, just to elaborate on that point as well, and this is where F1 Delta Time comes in. You know, it's the time you spend, right? You're right. Gamers spend, you know, hours and hours and hours of time. But the value of that time, the data that is generated from that time, who owns it? In the end, it goes to the game companies, right? So it funnels up to a small percentile of people who benefit from it. And generally, you know, nobody else sort of benefits from it other than the social and the entertainment value. So I think with F1 Delta Time, we decided to work with a brand like F1 for a couple of reasons. One, which is the right gaming audience that also understands value? Which brand is powerful in that aspect? Mm-hmm. No, F1 is a sport associated with value, a sport associated with capital, associated with you know, an audience that appreciates this stuff, you know, fast cars and money, I guess. The other thing is that, of course, there's 1.9 billion people who view F1, right? And there's 500 million fans. So, you know, if we're going to start with something to try to get blockchain adoption in gaming and entertainment, may as well try and do it with perhaps the biggest brand that we think is compatible with that. So that was F1. And I think the thing that we've seen some interesting validation with Formula One, which is a racing game, is that, you know, we make these incredibly beautiful cars, but also the licensed cars, like, you know, you can get Verstappen, you get Lewis Hamilton and the Mercedes cars and so on. You know, this one, for instance, just literally like, you know, like 30 minutes ago was auctioned for 2.6 million rev, which was roughly, what's that, $70,000 maybe, or $80,000 mm-hmm. in value. And wow. The other thing is, you know, we sold this track, right, which is, you know, and here's the concept of player-earned economies that is so different, which is that, you know, if I race on the track, then I have to pay to participate in the track. And of course, there's prize money, but the owners of the track are able to receive a return, much like rental income. And again, that's not possible in the game, in traditional gaming world, but in blockchain gaming, you can do that. This particular track sold for 9 million rev, which is at the time of sale worth 223,000 US. Wow. So, you know, these seem like rather eye-watering amounts of money. But when you think about it in terms of an asset, maybe it's not that crazy because they actually provide a return. Maybe the thing that is fascinating is that, you know, crypto and blockchain has actually created a financial infrastructure. You know, the community has built Wall Street, mm-hmm. but there is no way to really deliver services to them yet. And NFTs to us is that paradigm of assets, right? That you can collateralize, that you can buy, that you can do things with in the digital world, led through gaming. And so we think that that marriage is the reason why NFTs is going to really explode, as it has recently in the last 3 to 4 months.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, wow, that's really interesting, yeah, and I can't believe it's almost $250,000 for that track, but hey, that person now owns that part of that, so that's really interesting. And now with these partnerships and the brand licensing, I'm guessing, you're working with F1 directly. Obviously, this is going to bring a lot of exposure to them as well. You know, did you have to make certain relationships in order to make all of this happen?
Well, I mean, Animoca Brands, you know, and brands as a name in the company makes it clear. We do work with brand licensing partners as a general strategy of our company. So yes, I think we had to work with them. You know, licensing partnership deals take time. We have quite a bit of credibility in this space. We have, you know, within our group of companies, we have over 300 IP that we're working with today. So working with F1 is not an exception. It is more something we know how to do quite well. And, you know, it's, you know, F1 is not our only blockchain game project mm-hmm. that we're working on.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think the timing of this couldn't be better. And, you know, correct me if I'm wrong, but with the pandemic and the lockdowns, popularity of games have surged. And now, has that translated into growth for F1 Delta Time? Like, just is this perfect timing on this?
Absolutely. Well, I think, you know, we do have a non-blockchain gaming business as well, and that business has also really risen because everyone, as you say, is playing games at home. I mean, something like 75% increase in traffic. In other cases, you know, downloads have been up, like, you know, in some cases 6 to 7 times. So it has had an impact. Now, particularly as it relates to F1 Delta Time, right now we're doing a key sale, which is basically the equivalent of crates. We have to buy, that's where you buy cars and parts to play the game. In the 2019 edition, when we sold those, you know, those the value of those car parts have increased like, you know, 6 to 8 times. Because what happens is that once these assets are sold, we as a company actually don't own any anymore. Only the players do, right? Just like in the real world, if someone buys a real estate, you can't just suddenly magically make more real estate. Mm-hmm. You know, the person who owns it is the one who sells it, and so that's created trade and volume and interest amongst the people who own these assets. And those have done well because as more players enter it, well, guess what? They have to go buy it from some existing person mm-hmm. to participate. And so this key sale that we're doing, of course, when we did the first crate sale, we were at around roughly 350,000, maybe close to 380,000 US dollars. This last sale that you can see here, that's a deposit period. We still have another 4 hours to go. That's when people are depositing money into the pool, depositing the REV, so that they're able to participate in the sale. And we had a sort of target for a discount of 40 million. And we're now close to 60 million REV. I mean, 60 million REV represents somewhere between 1.5 to 1.8 million US dollars, right? So that is an incredible increase in just 7 months, right? So this is not something that just happened. We sold our first sale like 7 months ago, and now mm-hmm. we have this result. So,
wow.
You know, that's an interesting meta in terms of, well, has the industry grown? Yes, it has, right? just by the virtue of the sales that we're doing just on our pre-sales.
Mm-hmm. That's super exciting. And I really want to touch on and dive into a little bit more this REV token, because now there's non-fungible tokens where you can't interchange. It's for a specific car, track, something like that. But REV is a fungible token, and it looks like it's the gateway to acquiring these NFTs. But are there also other uses for the REV token, and how does it create that sustainable ecosystem?
Yes. So a couple of things that we found when we ended up doing the REV token, and a similar experience, another one of our projects is called Sandbox, and same with the Sand token, is that we discovered that actually the people who own NFTs and understand NFTs, even in the crypto space, is yay small. Okay, so there's like something close to 50 million crypto users mm-hmm. who own some kind of cryptocurrency. There's only 150,000 people who own NFTs.
Right? Wow.
Now you say, wow. So either this is a super niche industry or it has potential of growth, right?
Yeah.
And for a long time, we were floating around actually this very small number of NFT holders, you know, the people who bought CryptoKitties or our first sort of F1 cars. And what we found issuing a token was that actually it was a great marketing event, because crypto users, before even non-crypto users, were like, oh, let me buy this crypto token. And then they start learning about it and saying, oh, actually, I can actually do stuff with it. Because the vast majority of token projects that are out there have no utility, right?
Mm-hmm.
They have future utility. So you're really buying. And so I think it's fair to say that many of them are speculative in nature, just
mm-hmm.
because of the fact that you don't know what the outcome is yet. There is a white paper, a business plan, and maybe a great team.
Mm-hmm.
Or maybe even an anonymous team, which is kind of scary in my mind. And then here you have, with the gaming industry, you have actual product. You can use it. So
mm-hmm.
do you like it? Don't you like it? Up to you, right? You know, it's like, what happens if, for instance, someone like Fortnite actually were to make, you know, its V-Bucks an actual currency? You know,
mm-hmm.
what usage would you see? Tremendous usage, right? I mean, you see this already with people doing it with Miles, like what Qantas has done, for instance. It's become a currency of some sort, right? So that's kind of how we're using the REV currency, first to bring in the crypto community, but also to work with other motorsports. So we licensed Formula E, that's already announced. We licensed MotoGP. So the token represents the community of anyone interested in motorsports and interested in the entertainment, media, and gaming side of motorsports. And so you can participate with that. And we have many more motorsports brands we want to put into that and different game types. So essentially, it's like, come join the sort of, you know, Rev Utopia, or, you know, a Rev Disneyland, if you will,
mm-hmm.
and you'll have all these kind of games to play, in which some of them you can earn or you can do other things. The other thing is that we also allow staking of your NFTs.
Mm-hmm.
That's our rental product. So I can take the car, I can stake it into our sort of F1 Delta time, and then the owner obviously gets a return. But we end up then renting it out to players who may not necessarily want to spend, you know, that kind of money on a car, right? I mean,
mm-hmm.
the Bahrain car just sold for 70 to 80,000 US dollars. That's a lot of money.
Definitely.
So how can I experience it? You can rent it, much just like the real world. And people are now making a sort of reasonable income, thousands of dollars a month playing our games. And that's why we're so excited, because with the pandemic, you can't work outside. You can't do certain things.
Mm-hmm.
You know, where is half of the world actually spending their time? They're spending time playing games. So can we make gaming a productive thing when you
mm-hmm.
actually then really make income? And we think this is the solution.
That is super interesting. Yeah, especially when you can own it, you can lend it out and have interest. And then also there's a market for that, and it may be appreciating. It's like owning, You know, it's like owning real estate, but digital. So that's really
That's
cool. And now you mentioned the Formula E partnership and other partnerships, and that stuff sounds super exciting as well. Could you give a glimpse into what's in store for the first half of 2021 as you guys continue to grow and expand?
So I think the, you know, so we've launched the first set of games for F1 Delta Time with the Rev Token. We will be selling more assets for MotoGP very soon. That's coming out in the plan as well. We also announced a partnership with Flow, which is the company behind CryptoKitties, Dapper Labs, on that. And Formula E will also be coming out. So for 2021 in the first half, I think you'll be seeing the qualifier racing games for F1. We'll also be selling more tracks. We only sold the first track for you know, a fairly high amount of money. But I think there will be future track sales because we want to expand the ownership. And one of the things that we also want to be mindful is we want to make the ownership fairly distributed if we can, right? Just because that's a form of governance, right? You don't want it, you know, if you can prevent sort of an oligarchy, then maybe you, as you form this and want to create a real sort of democratic capitalist environment, you need to be able to sort of find ways in which you do that. So like with the key sale right now, you know, people can participate now and get a 50% discount because the target has been hit, at least for the next 4 to 5 hours. But we're also limiting purchases at 20 keys per purchase. So you can make many purchases if you like, but it's meant to give people a chance to do that. Because when we were selling real estate at Sandbox, we had an experience where it was all sold out within 15 to 20 minutes. And so many people were saying, I can't participate. Mm-hmm. It's not just not good for player engagement. It also means that ultimately many of the assets might come in the hands of the very few, mm-hmm. which is kind of a real world problem, right? So we want to make sure that that's more distributed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I really like that democratic capitalism. And also because there's so few people in NFTs compared to cryptocurrency, as you alluded to before, like a lot of people just don't understand yet or they haven't heard, but it sounds like you guys are really lowering the barriers to entry and also expanding out into the mainstream with these partnerships and doing what you can to make it fair and open. So I really do like that. Yet now we're running out of time, but there's a lot of people that I know are going to be interested in this. What's the best way for them to learn more, to get involved, and to get these NFTs?
Well, to get the NFTs, you know, go on to f1deltatime.com and check it out. We're also on Twitter. We're also on Telegram. We're also, of course, on Discord, which is where our most active community is. Mm-hmm. The other thing is, if you want to know more about the Rev token, go to revmotorsports.com. Check it out. We are, you know, trading on several exchanges, but actually most of our users, because they use them inside the game, end up actually swapping them on Uniswap, which is probably where most of the volume is, because they use it inside the games. And, you know, take a look at the stuff. We, you know, players own most of the assets, and I think this is something we're very proud of, which is, you know, we as a company obviously provide the platform and we have some stuff, but the majority of all of the F1 assets and NFTs are actually owned by our players. Mm-hmm. And that says something, right? You know, we, because it's a real player-owned economy where they can build something. And when you are participating, you're not buying it from a company. You're buying it from another player. And mm-hmm. that enriches their experience, their investment, and their commitment and involvement. That's, you know, that's the magic here, we think.
Mm-hmm. Thanks for that. Yeah, I will leave those links in the description box below for the viewers. It's been a pleasure speaking with you. All the best with F1 Delta Time moving forward into next year, and let's follow up in the near future.
Pleasure being here. Thank you so much.